very inspiring atmosphere. I'm very happy to be here because since morning, the kind of words that I've been coming across are nothing but positive. I see kindness ambassadors, you know, students wearing those badges, nicely showing it off. I see the words called care, giving, these kind of things very rationally being said here as if it is nothing. But believe me, the talks that I've heard today are one of the most inspiring ones, including the last one, that the lessons you learn of life come to you very late. So by the time you've realized what you actually want to do, what your passion is, what you're good at, all of these, by the time you arrive at that union, you're in your 40s. So here I am trying to demonstrate what the organization that I'm representing for does in terms of the passion and how I carry a little bit of it. So Youth for Jobs Foundation is a 10-year-old organization, well, 11. We work primarily in the disability sector and we work towards skilling and livelihood of persons with disabilities across the spectrum. So that is less educated, educated, women with disabilities, ex-servicemen and seniors with disabilities who still have a passion to work. Our core value, the last one I would stress, is that we believe that if you provide a job to one member of a family in poverty, the entire family is lifted out of poverty in a sustained manner. And that is what we focus on, which is why a job is the most important thing after education, of course. So what was the problem statement that we were looking at? So before Youth for Jobs formed, we looked at the statistics. And would you believe me if I said that 1 in 7 out of the world are disabled? And we are looking at about 60 to 70 million disabled people across the world. And 80% of them are from developing countries like India. So we are talking of a very, very large population who are disabled. And if I'm talking of villages, you must have heard all of us come from villages. And we understand that there is a certain taboo which is associated with disability, right? It could be a curse, you're not preferred, something is wrong, the mother is cursed. All of these taboos come for persons with disability. And that is the problem that we are trying to tackle. Twofold. One is that we are trying to understand what is the mindset which is required to be changed in order to make sure that this inclusivity doesn't become a word. Like, I don't want to talk of inclusivity like a CSR or a huge terminology. I want it to be a normal thing. I want it to be something that all of us are just doing, like tying a shoelace. It becomes something that back of our head. So changing mindsets is one that we're working on. And the second is, of course, providing a job. Because no matter how much of a mindset change you do, if the man is poor, everything is washed away. So you still need to see what will he feed himself and the family at the end of the day. And that's why we've looked at a very innovative scale solution in order to see how we can bring about this change. Scaling, like one of my previous speakers mentioned, happens first when you take the government in your side. Because like they mentioned, it's one of the largest scaled organizations. It's a huge, havelock of so many things. Then we looked at markets. Market value is important to us because remember, we are trying to provide a job and we need an employer and an employee at the same time. So if we're working at changing mindset, giving trainings and, giving them basic skilling to understand where they can fit in a job, then we are also looking at a complete mindset change of corporates. Our organization has been one of the reasons why the policy changes came in place in order to see that the ESG mandate is fulfilled. So I'm talking of changing attitudinal barriers as well as using technology, a very, very powerful sword, to see that we can scale with speed. And that's why technology comes into place. So we created something called as Project Parivartan. It's also called as WISE. That is Work Integrated Soft Skills in English. It is one of the largest scale projects that we have. We concentrate on 10th grade 12th grade as well as less educated. So even people who are less than 10th educated, we give them life skills. We give them skills in order for them to find a job in whatever they're good at. So one of the stories that comes to my mind here is there was a so in the villages of Karnataka, when we were traveling, there was a candidate who came up to us and he said, "I didn't study anything. Ma'am, I didn't even finish my 10th grade, but I want to do a job. Will you train me?" We trained him in something as simple as woodwork. And today he runs an organization where he's coaching 10 other people with him. It's a small organization, but he's a livelihood provider. These people came to be called as Divyang Mitra. So Divyang Jan, as you know, is the word for disability in India. So Divyang Mitra are people who are disabled themselves, but they work for disability. So it becomes a cause where we're saying it's of the disabled and by the disabled. That is our grassroots academy. I'll come to it in the next slide. Across our projects, we follow three main policies. One is advocacy. We believe that we have to advocate the mind of both the employer as well as the person with disability. There are communities which also need some kind of handholding there. For example, if a locomotor disabled were to attend this conference, how many of you can tell me at least three barriers which would prevent him from entering this hall? Steps. There is a small railing of iron even between the steps, right? So inclusivity comes as a big word, unfortunately. We still have a long way to go. And then I'm talking of a university, one of the premier institutes in the country is Usmania University. So we are a long way to go. There is still some time, but the path is set for it. Then there are company services. Companies come with a good mindset. Now at least we see a lot of conversion. A lot of companies are already converted. They say, yes, we want to hire a person with disability. And not just the locomotor disabled and speech and hearing impaired who form one of the largest labor market disabilities. I am talking of companies who are hiring hemophilia patients. They are hiring dyslexic patients. They are hiring people with Down syndromes. They are also providing entrepreneurship. You will find in the airports of Mumbai that students who have been trained by us and who are Down syndromes are running cafes. Mitti Cafe is one of the examples. They are an alumni of us who've set up an entrepreneurship of their own. Finally, we are dealing with placement. Placement just doesn't come with placing them in a job. There was a student of ours, Malleshwari. She joined an organization. She was a very qualified person. She did her post-graduation. After that, she proudly joined an organization. Within 10 days, she left it. So we asked her what went wrong, because we had given the skilling. We had also given the kind of interview skills that she needs in order to join the job. But there is a lot of taboo, right? So she was asked questions like, "Would you like me to take you to the lift?" Such a sweet, simple, kind question, right? What is wrong in that? But it is taboo. They believe in their ability and they want us to look at their ability, not their disability. So a lot of stigma runs around disability, which we also break even after placement. So we provide them those kind of services and support which is required post-placement up to 12 months. That's also a teamwork. We are a team of about 270 people across India. We are a pan-India organization. We are there in all the 29 states. And we've touched about 12.1 million households so far just through our sensitization. This is a product that I work for. I come also from an IT background, traveled the world, and found my calling in social sector and IT. So Swarajability, it's a portal which was developed for persons with disabilities. So it's like a Naukri, except that I pay special focus to see how each person with disability, no matter what he brings with him, is able to access the platform and access all of the company services and companies which exist in India. So far, we have about 1,200 companies who have joined this portal. They regularly take some kind of insights from us on how the hiring can happen, what kind of job roles can be created, what kind of jobs can be carved for persons with disabilities, and including accessibility services which they will need for their organizations. Most of them need a ramp, or some of them need a higher desk for a locomotor disabled. For example, if I were to sit here and give a presentation, most of you would try to peer, right? Right? So that's the simple kind of thing. If I'm putting a locomotor disabled person along with the other desks, I'll have to make sure that he's able to get out quickly in terms of a fire. Coming to that, in one of the French companies, NeoMotion, a very, very large company, for accessibility devices, they had asked us if we can do a workshop. The first thing we noticed was they hired a very large number of speech and hearing impaired, approximately 40 of them in one go. But when there was a fire alarm, what would the speech and hearing impaired person do? So we said, please install some red lights which blink, which indicate an emergency, right? So simple accessibility services, and all of those, you can access it even through the portal. So if you are an organization, actually any organization here, and if you think that you may be able to use persons with disability, not because you are sympathetic towards them, but because it makes business sense for your organization, let me tell you, there is a 15% increase in the work productivity, even if you hire persons with disability, because that is the kind of dedication that they come with. Then we moved towards WeDo, which is entrepreneurship for women with disabilities. So all of us women here, and actually I'm very proud that the whole organizing team has such a lot of women here. So as women, we come with a certain, you know, advantage. That is, if somebody were to tell me, hey, can you quickly organize this hall? Then I would have taken care of the water, the food. I'm sure that all of us are well fed here today. Samosas, tea, all of this, right? I would also make sure that if there are kids, then they are, you know, kept at the right place. So if I'm so involved and if I'm so engaged with how I run my household, I will put the same investment in running an organization as well. That is what the women come with. But women with disabilities have a certain bit of disadvantage. First, their own family thinks that they are not in a position to leave their homes because they may be taken advantage of. And we know that this is not something that is unknown to all of us. So they asked us, ma'am, ye skills to aap bahut achha de rahe hai, but I can't leave my home. My mom won't allow me. My father won't allow me. In some cases in Rajasthan, the father would drop the child at the skilling center and bring them back. I'm also talking of carrying them because they are completely, you know, with amputated feet. So we decided that we should provide some kind of skilling so that they can do entrepreneurship at home. Now in Karimnagar, we have about 450 families where women are entrepreneurs. They are doing things like tailoring, catering, even running internet shops or mobile shops where people are coming and learning and taking things from them. They earn about 9 to 10,000 a month. Happy families, happy women. This is a grassroots academy work that I was doing of, ma'am, that is from Rajasthan. And the person on the floor there is a floor walker called Prahlad. He was a person who did his master's. After master's, there were about two or three times that he did some suicide attempts because he could not make use of any of his skills. There was an entire family that he was supporting through his own tuitions. But that's about it. He had no other job satisfaction. We are looking at providing job satisfaction for persons with disabilities. So we told him, if you think you are mobile, feel free to go around. Today, Prahlad walks around the districts of Rajasthan, converts people, finds their mindsets, offers them services like registration into the government UDID, processes, etc., disability processes, and ensures that they end up having assistive devices such as this rickshaw. So those kind of things are also taken care of. This is our impact. I don't want to brag too much. Really, all of us have access to the internet and we can discuss, but I just want to tell you, 40% of our own workforce in the organization is women. 70% of our organization's entrepreneurship is by women. And we focus to see that although the numbers go high, the impact that we make is with our heart. And that is something that I'm very proud of presenting here. a few of our awards here. Our founder Meera Shanoy is very well known. She's receptive of most of the awards in this country. These are some of the awards that we are proud of. The National Award, she's also been mentioned in Prime Minister's Mann Ki Baat. Then for Swarajability itself, our jobs platform, we've received the Singapore Award for Women in IT. Presentation.